are these the freshers or they are senior ones also? This is the total batch? The size of the total batch, or there are some absentees from here? There seems to be a large-scale absenteeism. Why so? You are not interested in this beautiful story so beautifully narrated by Professor J.L. Gupta? How captivating is the story? And then, perhaps before, the child, the heir of the crown, was to be crowned, there was another sound which he heard, the voice of the conscience, in quietude and solitude and silence, where you can see the dew nourishing the grass, the sun warming the earth, but at the end of it, his journey, his sojourn, the boy here to the throne, he discovers that there is a voice, there is a sound of the conscience which every time sounds an alarm, every time cautions you about something going amiss, something going haywire. Such a beautiful story, inspiring story, captivating story, and the way he narrated it, it went down so well that you need to have the degree of sensitivity. You must learn to empathize with people and the society. But what is journalism all about? There's a girl, Hope, she's sitting there, Joshi, what's her full name? Mahak Joshi is her name. Many of you didn't have the occasion of interacting with this. I asked many students as to why are you keen in pursuing journalism mass communication? Why not pursue any other career? And she's the one who gave me the right answer. She has a role model who can inspire her and who inspired her. She is a 93%, she secured 93% marks. May not have done so in the CET, but she was keen in getting admission in journalism mass communication for the very conviction. And I was convinced with her conviction. I like Mahak Joshi to come here and tell me, is who the role model who inspired you, just to share with you the experience. Each one of you need to have a hero in life, a person who leads by example, a role model, because without that you will perhaps not be able to progress any further. I'll ask Mahak to share some small little, her very inimitated words. She will not bring anything foreign, no foreign element, no camouflaging, no twisting of words. In simple language, she will tell you as to why she chose journalism, mass communication as a career, in spite of my telling her that's a very, very demanding profession. It's 24/7 to 365 days, and many times you don't even get time to have a wink of sleep. Such a challenge job. You can be sometimes put on the crime beat, sometimes you are supposed to be at the site of an accident. By midnight you get a call from the desk editor and you are required to go and immediately dress up yourself in whatever shabbily dressed you are. If there's a demolition of a weak building and many casualties have taken place, like the, in one bridge in Maharashtra, one has to rush. One cannot care for one's dressing sense that I need to be very meticulously dressed. So Mac will tell her first-hand account of how she got fascinated by the media or by journalism or mass communication. I'll explain to you what the role of media and mass communication is later. Let her speak here. Please come.
So I'm certainly very inspired by Barkha Dutt, and I don't know if I could become like Barkha Dutt, but I would indeed be better than Barkha Dutt. So that's my inspiration, that's all.
In a school came Barkha Dutt. And the good entertainment that that woman possessed, she was thoroughly flabbergasted and thoroughly impressed that here is a role model whom I should try to follow, and not only follow her, but improve upon my skills so as to be called as better than Barkha Dutt, which is the highest award for journalism mass communication. Which Barkha Dutt won. Well, Barkha Dutt got many awards, but she got one specific award. And it's instituted in the name of a lady. I can give you that much of cue. You tell the teacher. Huh? What? The Chameli Devi Award. Chameli Devi Award. So the ladies have been the boldest and the bravest of the lot, and they were blessed with the sensitivity of a journalist. The heart bleeds for the poor, for the have-nots. They report with great sensitivity. They don't want to hurt anybody. Without hurting anybody, reporting is a very, very tough task, tough going. Now why is it called the fourth pillar? It's called the fourth pillar of democracy, or the fourth estate, we call it, E-S-T-A-T-E. The fourth estate, why is it called the fourth estate? No idea about media being called as the fourth estate? Stand up and reply. That's not the way you should reply. It's the link between what? No, absurd. It is absolutely absurd. You better unlearn this whole thing. It's never a link between the government and the people. No, it's not. Tell me anyone who knows. And this is the most hurting part of it, because you are completely ignorant as to why is media called the fourth estate. Yes, you come, baby. Come, my child, come. Come here, come here, come here. Be here, like she was there.
Okay, so media is called the fourth pillar of democracy because it keeps the other three pillars, which are the legislative, the judiciary, and the executive, in check.
No. Tell me again. I couldn't hear you.
It's the fourth pillar of a democracy because it actually...
Tell me the rest three.
It's legislative, judiciary, and executive in different sequence.
No. Should I correct you? It is the fourth estate, no doubt. Yes. But the rest of the three estates are wrongly spelled by you.
Okay, the sequence might be wrong, but...
Not the sequence.
Then?
Fundamentally, you are wrong. Anyway.
Thank you.
The basic requirement of a democracy is free and fair elections. If you want to be a democratic country, these are the four essential ingredients of democracy. Free and fair polls, free and fair elections. How many of you knew before that in democracy you need to ensure that there is a free and fair election? That's why the chief election commissioner is fully autonomous and is not under any government. It's not a government department. They take charge of everything. They take charge of the chief secretary of state. DMs are transferred at the whims and fancy, the chief election commissioner can order anything, and that particular officer may not remain in that particular constituency because he or she has a vested interest. So the chief election commissioner is an all-powerful institution which exercises its authority during the conduct of the election, so that the conduct of the election is fair and free. Fair and free elections. Even though it's very unfortunate that in my country there are no free and fair elections. The elections are most of the time rigged, and the muscle power, I mean, that comes into play. But that sometimes the press is not reporting those incidents of hooliganism and mass ransacking, and everything happens in the name of democracy. It's the naked dance of democracy. We watch it quietly, silently. So first requirement of a democratic state is free and fair elections. You have to ensure free and fair elections. Second is the freedom of press. Freedom of press. How free is the press today? I don't find the press free. How many of you find that the press is free to write anything that they want to? Or how far does the press serve a public cause, in the true sense of the word public cause? Sensational stories, yes, carried out, so that the TRP goes up. It's all a money game. Media barons control the media houses. The editors receive a daily briefing from the people who have bags full of money, and if the person is not doing the calling of the owners of the media houses, they get a marching order the next day. So second is freedom of press. First is free and fair elections. Freedom of press. Third is independent judiciary. Hey boy, you can laugh later, okay? I'm telling you, you're the bearded man. Yeah, you need to look straight, okay? Straight with your spine straight. Nothing of this kind is going to be tolerated here. If you want a quick discharge, I can get your discharge from here. You must have the inclination and aptitude to learn, okay? You can't sleep over my words. You need to listen to me carefully. So freedom of press, it is partially there, partially not there. But with whatever little freedom you can write with, you keep your conscience on the right side and try to be just and fair, and not for the heck of making a story. Sometimes those are disasters. Even today, two of the newspapers, sadly enough, Millennium Post and the Hindustan Times, did not report Article 399A, which is a constitutional amendment that took place in the year 1993, which created an assembly for Delhi. And then the transaction of business rules and everything. I think all of you must be sleeping over all this, that only Times of India referred to the constitutional amendment in 1993, thereby creating a state. So then there's something wrong with the person who's reporting, who's writing that's a victory for Najib Jung or Lieutenant Governor, and say, it's a complete, you know, face loss for the Kejriwal government. The manner and in which the stories are done is pathetic. Shows complete lack of ignorance of the constitutional provisions, complete ignorance about the transaction of business rules, and less said the better. Many times I have seen on the electronic media, in somebody's house, a murderous assault was made. Three people were bungee-jumped. They were hammered. A gruesome murder took place. and the reporter there who is taking a bite from the agreed family. But the person sitting there in the studio is not satisfied. He reports 3 deaths. He reports how gruesomely they have been killed. Gives all the description of the house. Gives where the bodies were found. What action has the police taken? But the most saddening thing part was when the person sitting in the studio says, but what's the body language of the, you know, people who live here? Body language. How do you want to take it? How can a person be who has lost 3 members of his family can respond? What could be his body language? Just find, how are they feeling? Can their feelings be ever felt by us? What a colossal loss. And its fallout for the whole family for years to come. The insensitivity is to this extent. You see, what's the body language of the man who has lost his wife and children? So, ladies and gentlemen sitting here, if you are pursuing journalism, mass communication, keep your eyes and mind open. You must listen to those silent cries of the affected people. Don't dehumanize yourself. Don't demean yourself. Because it's most of the time a paid news, which the vice chancellor registered, said, no, nothing doing, I'm not going to pay you 500 rupees for carrying out a news article on my university. He never indulged in cheap publicity. And that's where is the moment when you take a decision, either you put your foot down and say no to nuisance. No to nuisance. I know they have a greater nuisance value. These days, I mean, the newspapers or the small tabloids or small papers, 2 pages and 3 pages letters, you know, they are just being published for blackmailing honest people who represent certain values in their life. Those people are blackmailed very, very. The reporting is so bad, and the insult to injury is added by the right to information, and that information is also doctored, and the way it is reported also manipulated. So what are you doing in the process? You are hurting people, you are blackmailing people for a couple of 1,000 rupees. The moment you get some couple of 1,000 rupees, you stop reporting everything which is going wrong. They start discovering corruption even in a person who has stood by his integrity and honesty all through his life. And at the fag end of his life, he is just leveled with a charge, accusation, and the press picks it up and blows it up proportion it's given. So there are 3 types of media. The print media, still they have restraint because it goes at so many levels. Print media is the first. You learn how to write a piece. Second is electronic media, which you get enamored with. People will be able to see me on the television screen and be very happy and rejoice my accomplishment. The third is the cyber media. Right? And now another one, investigative journalism. And proactively they do it, and they go and get into the, you know, houses and the business places and the workplaces of people who are working very smoothly for the furtherance of their career. It is they who sting them, bring them, and then it is something like Cobra Post and sometimes Telka. And they are saying it's nothing but investigative journalism. But what it ultimately finally boils down to, if you shell a couple of thousand rupees or a million rupees, I'll be rich. At the latest incident that happened, there is a war going on between two business houses, the GTV and the Jindal's pipes. The Jindal house, and they're just, you know, these are two warring business houses, because they asked huge sum of 100 crores to uncover or to report this coal scandal, coal scam and other things, and he could not have afforded 100 crores for not having to report something. So he put his foot down and he said, I'll face all adverse publicity, I'll face the law, I'm prepared to go through the legal process, but I'll not get blackmailed by a media house. One media house blackmailing another business house. This is a glaring example. And then the media house owners, they are to the hilt defending that unethical news editor. They say everything, every expense, every penny spent on your bail application and right up to the acquittal, we will fund you. You don't have to do like this. So every evening, there's a DNA news by those tainted editors who went and brazenly asked, give us 100 crores and we will not be doing this kind of reporting. So the power of the media, you don't have to abuse. And remember this, the values alone will prevail and everything else that you are reporting is will perish. Sir will remember there was one gentleman called Abhiman Singh. He was the dean of the South Campus and was looking after the computer sciences department. He had put some VSATs there and he had for the first time imported some good computers with a good configuration and everything was transparent. But one of the newspapers reported there is a huge scandal in the computer sciences department of the South Campus. The moment the press reported that whole thing, they defamed that eminent professor. He went to the vice chancellor called Munis Raja. At that time, Munis Raja was the vice chancellor. He went to him and said, sir, it's defamation. I can't take it. I've lived with self-dignity and respect. They have tarnished my image. I am going to sue them for defamation. And then it's a moral. Though two ladies, are they listening or they are gossiping at the back bench? He says, you will get time to gossip, don't worry. We will give you time for everything. But this is time to listen to me, right? That you should be conscious of, that I am here. As long as I am present here, I will not like to see you indisciplined. If there is anyone, he will get the reward. We will hand over the punishment immediately. So please be attentive. So the story that I was telling you was about the insensitivity of the Abhiman Singh. So he went to Munis Raja and said, sir, I'm going to file a defamatory suit. He said, Munis Raja told him, Abhay, you tell me, jo waste hai, newspaper waste, for how much is it selling now? He said, only 4 annas. He said, if you keep on adding fuel to the fire, if you keep on picking one controversy or other, you will see that this particular waste, newspaper waste, is going to sell at 5 rupees. So don't escalate the value. Let them remain raddi. Raddi bikti hai na, bazaar mein. Ye raddi hai, kuch nahi hai, ek din ka kaam hai, usne tumko kar diya jo kar diya. But since you are a principled man, you are an honest man, you are a man of integrity, always believe in yourself. Always believe in yourself. Notwithstanding who says what about you. They may be telling all canards. They may be cooking every lie for you. But then that can be a recipe for a while. But that doesn't really last longer. Values will last longer. Howsoever, powerful, maybe the media barons who may like the story to be like they want it, but there are very many areas in the social sector. You need not be digging a defense scam, because there you want to pay people for leaking that information or for bringing to your office the file which may have certain notings which may prove that there is a scandal. You may not do those stories, but there are lot many things to be written and to be highlighted in the press. Start doing that kind of a welfare job. Reach out to the people who are in agony, who are being tortured, who are being made slaves, who are exploiting children. All sorts of exploitation is there. Start reporting. You should look for areas where you can do a very positive reporting. And if the newspaper sells, remember one thing. It sells only for such news. It doesn't sell for those one or two sensational news. There they want to make their buck. But 70% of the paper wants good news to be reported. You look for that 70%. Don't look for the 30% dirty business where you have to mortgage your conscience and forget about the values that your family may have passed on to you or the institution would like to pass on to you. So you are the second pillar. It's called the fourth estate because it, as per the laid down four pillars of democracy, the first it says free and fair polls. The second it says independent judiciary. Third it says apolitical army. The army has to be apolitical. It is not to work under the political influence. Because the army generals who are brave enough, who show well in the war, if they are given marching orders by one gentleman sitting at the helm of affairs, say, no, this man will not be the chief of the Western Command. He is being relegated to a very, very insensitive area like Eastern Command or Southern Command or the Central Command, which is the most useless. It's not a functional command. The most brave people and the brave generals are posted on the Northern and the Eastern Front to neutralize China, our neighbor, who is posing a nuclear threat, and so also the Pakistan. These are the two areas where the best of commanders, the finest of brave people are required to take the onslaught. So a political army should never politicize or never bend. Many times there have been voices against the armed forces, you know, that, what is that? Can somebody name about ESFA? Armed Forces? Special Power Act, correct? Absolutely. Lot of cries have been there. The whole lot of insurgency in Kashmir is being encouraged, and the voice also echoed that you better revoke it and let there be no armed forces, you know. The Special Protection Act. They want the army jawans to be sitting ducks. They want to scum to the wishes of the insurgents and the terrorists. And they very brazenly say, they very shamefully, they put up a statement, it's a struggle, you know, it's a freedom struggle, which they are fighting for their rights. How bad is that country? It's a rogue country. It should be categorized by UN that you get isolated as a terrorist state. We have been trying this on a diplomatic front, but they are a terrorist state. They sponsor terrorism and they encourage insurgency to weaken India, and that's where the army says, no, here we stand to defend you. They are courageous people, gallant people, and there you cannot bend them, ask them to bend forward and backward, because they have studied the area, they know the topography of the area, they know where to hit the enemy. So they have studied the whole thing, you know, the entire maps are there in front of them, and many of them are satellite maps, which clearly gives you the topography. Here there's a river, here there's a mountain of this height. Everything is measured there. We had in 1982, we had acquired from German satellite the imagery of that place, and that virtually tells you where to hit the army the most. So you have now your own technology which is so far advanced. There are many people reporting on science and technology. Be one of those. Be sports reporters reporting on sports. So you have to choose areas where your integrity is not compromised, where every good thing is reported. Just now there was doping test and anti-doping and doping, commission. So you need to know how do they detect, how do they collect the urine samples and find out steroids there in the form of corticosteroids, hydrocorticosteroids. If you don't study that, your reporting will be half. If you don't know what are androgenic hormones and what are other hormones, you will not be able to justify. So you need to be well-informed people. The journalists are supposed to be well-informed people. And they try to educate and expand their horizons of knowledge. They get information from different sources, from different disciplines. They interact with the best of doctors. Everything, you see, you need to learn and have an all-encompassing knowledge which makes your reporting very objective and meaningful, and it will have a long-term impact on the society. You have to be those journalists. You don't have to be every journalist. Now, Barkhadat chose to go to the Kargil when it was shelling going on, and the army said it will be at your own risk, and they want you to sign an undertaking. Remember this. Whenever a journalist goes, the army commander's standing instructions are, these are areas which are forbidden for the journalists to reach out to this place because there is a risk to their life. Once cleared, once you have been cleared, once you say, I am at my own risk, I don't care if I die for the motherland, my brothers and sisters are fighting here, then you are allowed in the operational areas. You are allowed near the line of actual control. And when you see the line of actual control and the way patrolling goes and how disciplined are those soldiers, I mean, it's something that we should learn to discipline ourselves, that they are also like us. Why can't we afford to be disciplined? Why can't we enforce discipline in our lives? Because discipline begins from home. If you are disciplined people, your conduct will be ideal. Your conduct will be okay. You'll be viewed as good citizens of this nation, which it requires. It's a dire necessity of this nation to have responsible citizens. So I was telling you four pillars of democracy. Remember these. First is the free and fair polls. Second is independent judiciary. Third is apolitical army. And the fourth is freedom of press. There are two organizations which are working in this direction. One is the Press Trust of India and the Press Council of India. Who will tell me which of the two is powerful or what are their areas of operation? Any one of you? There is something called Press Trust of India. Its office is the Parliamentary Street, right? It's an agency, reporting agency, right? Earlier there used to be teleprinters, and now they have been replaced by quick fax machines and other means of communication. Where the entire, this is an information pool. And why it's called Press Trust of India? Because it's a government organization. But the reporting is very authentic. If the Press Trust of India says that such and such person, Anandibhen, has resigned in Gujarat, the first report will come to the Press Trust of India. United News of India. These are news agencies which collect information and then dissipate that information. Then comes the Press Council of India. It was supposed to have a supervisory role over the irresponsible journalists. But it's called the toothless tigers because legislation does not provide any punishment for the journalists. You can go scot-free because there's an editor's guild which is more powerful, and those editors exercise greater powers, at best they will reprimand you for a bad reporting. Or for a yellow journalism, if you are indulging in yellow journalism. The Press Council of India, from my point of view, should be a very powerful body to discipline the journalists, because everyone in India requires discipline in the respective areas. Without discipline, there is nothing. If you are indisciplined, then perhaps no accountability. You have done a bad story and nobody can hold you accountable, because the Press Council of India doesn't enjoy those powers. The Editors Guild of India, they will come in defense of the journalists and defend them even if they are absurdly wrong, they are outrightly wrong. That's the tragedy of this country. We have not given powers to the Press Council of India to hold people accountable for their false reporting or for having to twist the facts, and you know, many things are done to damage somebody. You have damaged it, colossal damage has been done to one's reputation. The man stands destroyed, it will take time for him to recover his reputation and redeem his prestige. But then, no action taken because the Press Council of India doesn't have any powers. Supreme Court, retired Supreme Court judge presides over it. A officer of the rank of Additional Session Judge is the secretary of that Press Council of India. But still, no action so far has been taken against any journalist, howsoever responsible journalist that may be, or howsoever colossal damage he or she may have done to the society. So be responsible citizens, remember. Uphold those ideals which have been passed down to you down the millennium by seers, sages, ascetics, by other people. And listen to that sound of conscience, you know. Your own conscience will speak. You are doing something wrong, it will raise its voice, it will assert itself, but it asserts itself in it to a very limited extent, to the extent you listen to that voice of the conscience. You start avoiding it. No, this is what is being recommended by my inner voice. There is something called inner voice. You dub it each time, it tells you not to do, not to do, not to do. Then it says, this man cares, hoot for me, I also dump him. And that wild voice start getting dimmer and dimmer and dimmer and dimmer. And then you have no conscience, in fact, and no voice of the conscience, no sound of the conscience. You get guided by your own whims and fancies, and you end up into rackets of all kinds, right from drug racket to whatnot, and not so many hookah bars running, so many mio running, so many people go to such places which vitiates your mind and pollutes your conscience. And then there's nothing left in this life except destruction. You are bound for destruction, you are bound for destruction. The wickedest the idea comes, please try to resist it and entertain the noblest ideas, most uplifting ideas. Be people of virtues rather than vices. Must you earn people's accolades, appreciation, recognition, everything. You should not be looked down upon. I have nothing except that I want each one of you to be a very responsible journalist. Whichever field you choose, be sincere to yourself. You must have a sense of commitment to yourself and to your job. Do it judiciously, fairly, honestly, and one day, the days are coming when good people are going to get recognition. Good people will also start getting reported. A martyr sacrifice on the border can never go unreported. Listen to me. So what is that? That compels the press to report it. Even if they are not wanting to do it. What is it? Batra, Vikram Batra? Vikram Batra. Huh? Vikram Batra was a martyr in Kargil who won the Veer Chakra, Paramveer Chakra Prapta, recipient of Paramveer Chakra. Vikram Batra, then Kshetrapal, the boy. These young men who committed, you know, they were martyrs. they sacrifice their lives so that we can live in peace. That supreme sacrifice, no power on earth, no press on earth will be able to subvert it or curb it. Because that is the ultimate truth. And the truth has a face. And it triumphs finally in life. So you should uphold your values, establish those highest ideals in your journalism, in a field of journalism, and remember, one day recognition will come to you. History tells that people who seek after chair, chair eludes them. And the moment you stop caring for the chair and start making sacrifices, Swamiji said, Swami Vivekananda said, all great accomplishments are made through great sacrifices. So remember, the highest sacrifice is needed. In terms of control over your sleep, in terms of control over your food, once you keep yourself balanced, you are always mentally fit, mentally agile, and physically fit to take up any challenge in life, and there you will get the recognition. J.L. Gupta sir was referring to in being and becoming. Swami Vivekananda said, each one of you can be Vivekananda. Each one of you can become Vivekananda. How? You can notify in the press that I want to change my name from this to this. There's a small joke about it. There was one gentleman, Bill Stinks was his name, and he wanted his name to be changed to William Stinks. And when this whole thing was, you know, he published a small notice as is required by the law, that you need to give it a small advertisement in the press that you want to change your name from this to this. He completed all the legal formalities, and then finally he approached the judge. So he said, yes, I have pursued on perusal of your paper, I have seen that you want from Bill Stinks to William Stinks. He said, yes, sir. Now, how does it matter as long as you keep stinking? You keep stinking. How does it make a difference if you are Bill Stinks or William Stinks? You stink in any case. So changing names, he said, you can change the name to Vivekananda, and each one of you can be Vivekananda, and Mother Teresa's, and the ladies can even become Sister Nivedita and whatnot. Those great souls, inspiring souls. But then Swamiji said, if you want to become Vivekananda, it will take you at least 100 years. There's a difference between being and becoming. So become those heroes. Follow those, emulate those examples who have left a legacy of valor and courage and have stood by their ideas and never bowed down to it. Thank you very much.